scholarly academician, but also has an immense experience of 34 years in corporate work. Dr. Basu was the group controller of SR Group and has also been the CFO of Reliance Communications Limited. Now, sir is a senior professor of NMIMS School of Business Management and also the program chairperson of MBA Law. Sir is also a PhD holder on transfer pricing from Calcutta University in 1999. Sir has conducted various management training programs, presented and published score of research papers, interviews, case studies, etc. across national and international summits and conferences. We would like this to be a very interactive session and we would like you obviously gain a lot from this. Now I would like my professor, Ms. Soini Srivastava, to present a proposal.
Good morning to all of you. Is the morning good for all of you?
Yes.
It was really little bad for me because when I started from home, I should have reached here by around 9:25. But we had constituted two accidents in the highway. So I got late and that's why the delay in starting this program. So I'm going to talk about blockchain technology, and there was a specific advice to me that I'll be giving a specific emphasis on the smart contract part of blockchain technology. So I will also, this is the first presentation of mine where I will be dealing on smart contracts in a little detailed way. My theme, I'll draw the theme from what I spoke in Moscow in the World Blockchain Summit when I presented the keynote speech. I talked about two things, blockchain for all, blockchain for inclusive smile. If blockchain has to be for inclusive smile, it has to be for inclusive growth, it has to be for inclusive happiness, and inclusive happiness will come only when you share the sustainable benefits of technology with the people in the lower rung of the society. Okay, so that's what is my theme, which I carry in all the speeches of mine on blockchain technology. I will be using a lot of graphics from the freely available internet sources, so I acknowledge their indebtedness, my indebtedness to them, and there is no purpose other than using them for. So let me quickly take you through the human civilization. In human civilization, you saw first in 1780, we saw the human and animal energy getting replaced by steam engine. And the power of steam engine was utilized for almost a century till 1870, when in 1870 we got the electricity, right? We got electricity in 1870 and gradually industrialization came. After the industrialization came, we got electricity getting converted electrical to electronic. And in 1970, we got the third industrial revolution of the world when we brought computing capability in a machine. We got computing capability, we got computers, we got CNC driven machines, we got automations, etc., etc. We got 1970, we got the automation, and the industrial revolution got into an automated revolution. In 1980, the distance got killed by WWW. And we had globalization. Globalization is considered as the Industrial Revolution 3.5, and today we are in 4.0. The 4.0 is the digital revolution, okay? Now, you lawyers, you have seen some of the laws in India are 150 years old, right? And many of the laws are getting repealed and new laws are being done, and one of these is Companies Act 1956 getting repealed in 2013, right? So what is the realization of the world is, what has brought us from there to here will not take us there. So we have to have a substantial change. So we started after World War I, we started with a value scorekeeping function And now we have got into value aggregation function, right? So when value aggregation function started, it started at an advanced level of scorekeeping by computing. Now from value aggregation level, now it has gone to a different level. And what is that level? Let us look at. This is a technology mapping, and in technology mapping, it has been told by the digital scientists that the entire digital technology can be divided into two major groups. One group is a transformational group, which transforms the way of doing business, and one group is an impact creating group. In the transformational group, you have 3D printing, automated cars, you have brain, human brain and machine interface, you have advanced robotics, you have machine learning and smart machines. Those I don't want to, this is not area of our discussion today. Our area of discussion is blockchain. My research on blockchain for last about 1.5 years tells me that originally when scientists started putting blockchain as a transformational, as a business impact technology, it was just sitting on the borderlines of transformational and business impact. It has somewhere been established by the world today that blockchain is going to be not even a transformational technology, it's going to be a foundational technology. I'm going to come to this a little later. So, originally used to make plan in the business and then take it to the market and executing it. Today, we are not going to do this. Today we are going to reverse map our business strategies from the market to the business, then create the tactics around it and then take it back to the market for execution. So the digital world has helped us to understand the market is a much better world and do much better customer satisfaction and customer management oriented work. Recently I spoke on AI and customer satisfaction management in one of the international level. So, what is being thought through is that in the digital world, the application of any digital technology is meant for doing things differently than what we used to do earlier. Of course, the whole thing has to be done keeping IT jurisprudence in mind, because the human civilization, when it started and when litigation started getting management, the original management of litigation used to be done by legal evidences, which are physical evidences, right? Either by a physical person or by a physical document. Now it is going to be a digital person in a digital document. I talk about who is a digital person. A humanoid robot is a digital person. I talk about it a little later. Okay, so scientists have now told us, and this is a PwC study, that there are going to be robots, drones, 3D printing, blockchain, virtual reality, augmented reality, and Internet of Things. These are the 4+4+8 technologies which will be working in a big way during the course of 2020 and going forward. But my prediction and my research says that blockchain is not a standalone technology. Blockchain is such a technology which can be used simultaneously with more than one of these transformational technologies like drones, Internet of Things, 3D printing, and robots, all these things can be tagged up to blockchain for a better work, and maybe more than one thing can be tagged up to blockchain for better work. We'll come to this in later when we talk about Industrial Revolution 5.0. So I'll take you to Bhagavad Gita now, because you have seen the misuse, abuse, and negative impacts of technology, right? People are saying that AI may entirely destroy the human civilization. So I say here, we are born into the world of nature. Our second birth is into the world of spirit. But if I want to serve my mind with my strong body, will give up and will not be worthy of doing good work for human civilization. So any work which we do in the digital world 4.0 era is to be by spirit, by imagination. So I will be requesting you to, throughout the next about 2.5 hours of this discussion, I would like you to think in a bit imaginative way, okay? Fine. So this is Eastern philosophy, which talks about spirit. Look at what Albert Einstein said decades ago. He said, the true sign of intelligence is not knowledge, but imagination. So even if you are a lawyer who believes in words of law and evidences, you have to be a bit more imaginative when you deal with the law and the digital. Okay? So look at this particular slide. This slide says, this is a Deloitte University research. By 2030, there were 4.4 jettabyte of data in the world. 1 jettabyte of data is equal to 1 billion terabyte. 1 billion terabyte is equal to 1 jettabyte. And 4.4 jettabyte of data was there in 2013. 2017, it will go at a CAGR of 39%. It will increase to 44 jettabyte of data. Can you imagine 44 jettabyte of data? This is the digital universe we are talking about. But the irony of it is that while the data will be 10 times, its usability through analytics will be only increasing from 22% to 37%. So there will be not only 15% increase, but also there will be 37% applicable to 10 times of the data to be created. Right? So huge amount of data which will be created, and legal evidences and lawyers' work will not be beyond it, let me tell you. Lawyers are already frightened that artificial intelligence bots and chatbots are going to be used for legal function also. Okay, so the issue here is this 37% of the data, whether it can be further increased for doing the service to humanity much better. Another problem is that these days data is not getting generated from static devices like this. Data are getting generated for dynamic devices like this. But the beauty of this dynamic device issue is that while it helps the human civilization, but capturing the data for digital analysis is a difficult problem. That's why it is being said that 27% of the data which is generated by the physical devices, which is moving, perhaps would be difficult. More than 27% would not be possible. So the real challenge is using blockchain analysis or blockchain as a tool simultaneously with artificial intelligence, deep learning and machine learning for more analysis of data. And as you analyze data, you do a better management of humanity. Okay? So that's the idea of blockchain. Question is, what is blockchain? I take you to the real world. Many of you are having banking experience through your mobile phone or your device, right? Every damn thing you do, the entire data is centralized into the banking system, right? Entire data is centralized into the banking system. But this story is not true. In 2006-07, 2011-12, I was in the last few years of my industry, we used to integrate host-to-host servers of banks with the server of the corporates. Like, I used to process my payment transaction details through an API, application program interface, I used to push it to the server of banks, and banks need to process the payment, and after the payments are processed, banking used to reverse push the data to me, saying that these payments have been pushed and done. And after those checks or payments used to be debited into my ledger, bank used to send me a bank statement. Similarly, the status was true for my collections. Because my customers used to deposit the collection money directly to my system. So we saw application of decentralized database management through host-to-host server integration. Blockchain is neither of these two. Blockchain is this one. In these two pictures you are finding, here there is one central point, and there is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 center points. But in the third picture to your right, there is no center point. In blockchain, there is nothing called centralized database management system. It's a decentralized data management system or decentralized data management scheme. It is called DDMS. What is the beauty of this, system? Each one of the participants will be able to see each other's data. And if you have to hack any banking system, if you hack this machine, the whole data is hacked. In a decentralized system, if you hack these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 ledger systems, you are hacked. But the God's computer can only have the decentralized database management system. Only God's computer. You need a supercomputer with huge machine power, which can simultaneously hack all these data which are stored. And it is not my data is in my computer. All the data of all the transaction participants are in the computer. Okay? So the simple point here is this particular item is almost non-hackable. Okay? We'll come to it later. Now let's look at how a blockchain technology works. I'll give you a board level example. Let me take the example of healthcare system. Suppose this is the blockchain for healthcare. Okay, this is the blockchain for healthcare, and I as a patient, I have to do my knee surgery. So how do I get into the healthcare system, which is a blockchain? So I'm a patient here. I participate in the blockchain. I'm a patient, and when I participate in blockchain, I'll have two keys. One key is my private key, and one key is my public key. What is the private key and public key? Whenever today you get into a banking system today, the password through which you log in is known to the bank, right? And they say that we do algorithmic generation of OTP, which is not known to the bank. But after the transaction is done through the OTP, the transaction gets logged into the banking system. So bank knows everything in a centralized database management system. Here, my private key is my personal key, and there is a public key. When I publish any transaction in a blockchain, I will not be known by Dr. Prithosh Basu. I'll be known by only a number. That's all. So I announce here that I want to do a knee operation. Now in this system, there are surgeons, there are hospitals, there are insurance companies, there are banks, at times banks do not participate, and there are pathological laboratories, there are medicine suppliers, and there could be a consultant physician from America, consultant surgeon. Okay, so these are all the participants into this blockchain. So the moment I say that I have to do a knee operation, at that point of time, I could have been an insurance holder or may not be an insurance holder. Suppose I am not an insurance holder. Before announcing, I will do an insurance, medical insurance, maybe 1 month before, 1 year before, I don't know, I'm doing a knee transplant. So when I buy an insurance, I announce that I want to buy an insurance for healthcare. So this insurance company who is a participant, there will be more than one insurance companies, they will give me a quote based on my requirement. When they give this quote based on my requirement, one of the participants' quote I accept. The moment I accept, I am participating through a note, and this insurance company is also participating through his note. Note is nothing but the computing system of the insurance company. This transaction of taking an insurance becomes a block. Okay? Done? So, all the participants of the blockchain system now knows that Mr. Public Key has an insurance drawn from so-and-so insurance company whose public key is this. Right? Now I announce that I want to do a surgery. This surgeon, there is surgeon 1 to surgeon A. Suppose surgeon, 3 surgeons or 4 surgeons, they quote their value. That this is the value I will charge you. So I say that okay, I want you to consult a US surgeon while you are doing my surgery so that he sees what you are doing with my knee. So this particular person is asked to participate in this. Now what happens? This surgeon gives a quote, announces the transaction that so-and-so public key has got a requirement of supervision by a foreign doctor while I am doing a surgery. So now this is more than one contract. A surgeon giving a quote, another surgeon doing a supervision quote. These three people, the patient, the surgeon, and the supervisor, the surgeon from US, do an acceptance. And this acceptance now becomes a transaction, getting another block into the chain. Okay? Now, there are three physical points, touch points in this blockchain. One is the doctor, one is the pathologist, and one is the hospital. Otherwise, there will be no physical touch point. Now, I need some pathological testing. So this surgeon announces a transaction that such and such public key holder wants to have such and such testing done pre-operation. So this, either these pathological laboratories or certain hospitals gives a quote. When the quote is done, it is given by their public key. 3, 4, 5, 6 quotes comes. I accept a quote. When I accept a quote, this particular transaction is now getting attached to this block. So one by one transaction getting attached to the chain of block for one knee surgeon. And it will follow the same way. After that, the hospital will give a quote for operation theater. I will accept. When I am doing all this, my insurance company is continuously supervising my account that this guy is accepting so much of money. The blockchain system will be having an alert. You have accepted the insurance company's quote, doctor's quote and pathological quote and hospital quote. Please be alerted that so much of money is within your limit, so much of money is beyond your limit. So the guy is not waiting for post-operation time to know how much he will get, how much he will not get. He is getting immediately known to him. Because through a system, the insurance company is also endorsing the final bill of 2 surgeons, hospitals, medicine suppliers, and the pathological laboratories. Once these transactions are completed, the operation takes place. Then the doctors announces before the operation is done, of course there will be an anesthesist doctor. So anesthesist doctor can be arranged by the hospital, I can have my own anesthesist also. So all these things, what is happening? All these things are happening in an integrated manner, in a real-time online basis, where the participants don't know each other, they are working. The insurance company did not know who I am, because when I am onboarding into this blockchain of healthcare system, I am completing my KYC to prove that I am a physical person. How this KYC is done, I will be talking to you a little later. Okay, so Shweni will be finishing this program at 1:30? 1, okay, so I will cut short a bit. So, quickly, let me tell you one thing. The explanation which I have done in the board here is the same thing here in case of a banking transaction. From this computer, when transaction is being announced, one of the participants in accepting, once the acceptance is done, it gets attached to a block of transactions. So this is what exactly is blockchain. What are these? I'll explain to you in greater detail. So, when all these things are being done, in a normal system of transaction like in SAP or in Oracle Financial or in Fidelity or banking, these are not cryptographed. In blockchain system, every damn thing is cryptographed. Any data storage, any transaction data is completely cryptographed with complex algorithmic logic. And in some of the blockchains, this algorithmic logic change every 10 minutes. That is, the cryptographic processes change every 10 minutes. If the algorithmic logic changes every 10 minutes, it renders the system much more immune to hacking. Okay, I spend a little extra time on this for you to understand what is blockchain technology. So the technology has taken a quantum leap in terms of speed, quality, reliability, transparency, privacy, data storage. Because in this process, if anybody has to, doctor has to upload the prescription, or the hospital has to upload the digital copies of the CT scan or sonography report, etc. All these documents are also uploaded in the blockchain's data library. That is also crypto. So every damn thing is crypto. Okay? So, Harvard Business Review said that blockchain technology is a disruptive, is not a disruptive technology. People say today, like you young guys, who have, whenever you see any new software or digital platform, you say it's a disruptive technology. Blockchain is not a disruptive technology. It's a foundational technology which can lay the foundation of the structure of your society and the economy of a country. And this foundational relaying of the structure of society and economy can by all means change the whole world of administration. Here is a very unique set of data for you. You have heard about Gartner. Gartner is the world's most respected technology reviewer and researcher. This Gartner has said that by 2025, $176 billion worth of currency value addition. I'm saying value addition, not amount spent for blockchain technology. $176 billion would be value addition by blockchain technology. Gartner immediately adds that by 2030, another 5 years time, blockchain will add $3.1 trillion. $3.1 trillion. So $176 billion. The $3.1 trillion will be the value addition. How they will add value? You can say all business transactions add value. How can blockchain can add value? Blockchain can add value only by minimization of value destruction. And also allowing more transactions to happen and with the ease of transaction. The same subject was reviewed in the World Economic Forum held last year. And it has been predicted there that by 2027, 10% of the global GDP will be held into blockchains. By 2030, the global GDP is expected to be $110 trillion. So if I apply, say, 10% of $100 trillion, blockchain will be having $10 trillion of worth of transaction inside blockchain. And let us meet the MSMEs of the world who will not participate in the blockchain mostly. Think of what is the gigantic size of world trade which will be controlled by blockchain technology. Okay, so the interesting part of this understanding is that blockchain is here to stay. Blockchain is here to add value. Blockchain is not here to add any disruption to any business. Blockchain is here for simple value addition. Okay, this gentleman, Christopher Fabian. Christopher Fabian is the guy who, one of the founders of the UNICEF. one of the founders of UNICEF Innovation Center. This gentleman in 2016 predicted three things: that the problems in the world about the impoverished children, that is the poor children and malnutrition, blockchain is one solution which will help impoverished children's solution of problems. The second he said, and this is based on the research conducted by the people who work for UNICEF all around the world in the villages and towns, they say that blockchain will be a very interesting solution for identity management. If you see the passport, I went to Zimbabwe, I presented my passport, immediately they saw my details. What is this? My passport only has a barcode, nothing else, for the Zimbabwean lady to see in her computer everything. Right? This is nothing but a quasi-blockchain. Why I call it a quasi-blockchain? Because it is not founded on the principles of blockchain, but it is a blockchain. Because worldwide, in the central passport system of the world, you can see anybody's passport anywhere in the world. Okay? So this gentleman has said that the identification management would be the best. And the third one, which he said, is the solution for remittance from one country to another country. I am presently consulting a company in Bangalore who will be using, or who is using blockchain technology of its own, by which a migrated worker who migrated from Canada to Dubai, if he pays $10 today for sending 1000 AED to his wife, will be paying only $4 to send the same 1000 AED to his wife. 60% will be the reduction, and that will be the value savings to the poor migrated worker, and he will be definitely having the benefit of blockchain. And that's why I say blockchain for inclusive smile, blockchain for inclusive happiness. If I can save $6 for him from his hard-earned money, I will be able to see some happiness and some smile in his face, right? And that is the theme I always use for blockchain. Now I come to your subject, and your subject is smart contract, right? So I'll take a pause for 2-3 minutes, and now I'll not take a break. I'll give a break, don't worry. I'll give a break at around 11:30. But I will now take a pause and try and understand what is the understanding of yours about smart contract. What do you understand? Let us start from the red signal. You are wearing red, so I take you as a red signal. Yes, sorry. So what is a smart contract? Any idea about what is smart contract?
I'm sorry, but I don't know what.
Can you guess?
Sir, I think smart contracts would involve.
Why it is called smart?
There's no intermediary in the building.
There is no
intermediary.
Yes, you are right. One of the attributes, yes.
It's only the person who enters the contract, the execution is much more simpler.
Okay, it's simpler, speedy, what else?
And if it's speedy, it's cost effective as well.
Okay. You are giving the impacts of smart contract. You give me the attributes of the smart contract. Anybody else will try? Yes. Chalo, if I type a computer in a contract in computer by using highest of the word doc capability of MS Office and then shift it to internet, will it get smart contract?
Could be, but so I know one of the contract which is called K-Trap contract, which comes with the softwares which we install in our system.
Right. So you have hit the ground.
Yeah.
It is embedded in the system.
Yeah, correct.
That's the attribute.
So the main function of that agreement is that it shows the whatever the terms and conditions of the contract is, and now it is on us whether we agree or disagree. So that moment we agree the moment we hit the agree button, we are into that contract.
Absolutely, right. spot on point. Let me tell you, it is not, you have to like only go for a opening any bank account or fixed deposit, you will say agree, and without seeing 200 clauses we agree. In smart contract you don't have to do that.
Yeah.
If you, it is flexible, if you want to change certain language, through this blockchain process you can change. Okay, we'll come to that. Thank you so much. So there is some understanding, Shreya, I'm so happy about smart contract in this classroom. So, don't read this, I'll explain to you what I've tried to write here. So, what has been you lawyers will be insisting in life that nothing works in this world without having a contract, right? Because subsequently, if anything wrong happens and people get into litigation, contracts and evidences serve the purpose. Okay, so this is true for business. Suppose a municipality takes taxes from me, but as municipalities say, that the roads will be swept or once in a week or every day? No. Right? Similarly, on 17th and 18th of December in Kolkata, there was a blockchain conference, and India's first birth certificate of a baby was used from blockchain by the Salt Lake municipality of Kolkata. It's the first in India. Okay? It was used for, issued from blockchain. How it was taken? The parent of the block of the baby logged into the system, gave the hospital serial number, and the parent got the birth certificate of the baby. Hospital details, birth time, parent's name, everything. Doctors who did the work and etc. etc. Everything came in the system, but the certificate came out. It's a digital certificate. Now, you lawyers will say, is there any application of legality in this? The answer is yes. Take the case of Aadhaar. When you, till the Supreme Court judgment came, when you went to buy a SIM card, you just give the Aadhaar number, rest is in the screen of the telecom operator, right? Do you think it's a smart system? Answer is yes. They don't need any document from you except your PAN card. Because every damn thing about yours is there in the system. Okay, so if this process has to work, there has to be a legality to it. That means the government has committed the service of birth certificate to be given by the organization. Certain systems and procedures and policy guidelines have been decided. Certain do's and don'ts are there for the government not to disclose the data. And certain do's and don'ts are there for the parents also, and in future the child will grow up, about the rules to be followed for utilization of this birth certificate, right? So all these things are pre-agreed before the birth certificate is obtained, right? So there is a contract. But all these things are happening in 10 minutes time. How it is happening? If you want to read the entire government's policy guidelines, you can read and write. But you know, as a citizen of the country, government will not do anything wrong with you. Because the law has been passed. And according to the law, government is giving you this certificate. And government is committed to privacy. So, we just accept. And you get the birth certificate. Right? So, what is being said here, whatever you do in a quasi-business, business, or non-business transaction like birth certificate, you need to have an agreement between the parties involved. Like in Australia, old age home is run by blockchain. Oh. Suppose I am at 65, I want to go to old age home at my 68 years age. Around 50, I will block the old age home room. Through blockchain. I do payments and I'll be allotted. So the old age home will be run in such a manner that on the 68th birthday of mine, I will get a room allotted to me in that old age home, and this all through blockchain. Charity and donation management, the biggest of the frauds takes place in NGOs in this. This can be done through blockchain. So, business, quasi-business and service-oriented things can be done through blockchain based on certain terms and conditions which is embedded into the digital system, as you have said, and I am in a position to either change or not change, accept, not accept. And when I click, it is not only my acceptance. The guy who has offered me the service to blockchain, he has pre-accepted it. He is waiting for my acceptance only. Take the case of this healthcare system. The guy who has generated this blockchain, he has taken some standard healthcare pre-agreements, which can be done by the patient and the certain patient and the insurance company patient and the hospital visit and the pathological. Pathological laboratory has the highest data privacy requirement. Because whether I'm a blood sugar patient or not a blood sugar patient, well, the world cannot know about it except the doctors. So everything is there embedded in the digital system of blockchain. And everything is self-initiated. Every single person who is coming into the blockchain is self-initiating the contract, self-accepting the contract, and self-executing the contract. Yes? I tell you, in blockchain, when you want to say you issue a transaction, every damn thing which you do in blockchain is called a transaction. You issue a transaction, I want to change clause number so and so, and my device clause drafted in the attached doc, and you upload it. It is directed, the guys who are interested to this transaction, he gets to know that this public key has announced this change. The interest party is suppose the insurance company. Insurance company will review it. But let me tell you, insurance company is regulated by IRDA, right? So insurance company's clause which has been drafted is in line with IRDA. So you as a citizen of India, you cannot change IRDA guidance. Neither the insurance company can change. So answer is, hopefully there will be no change. If at all there is any change, in a commercial condition it can be changed. For example, you are importing a machine from Germany and you are saying Bureau Veritas has to do the quality control, right? Now you say, no, I don't need Bureau Veritas, I need XYZ, the company who should be doing the quality control. You can change it. The guy who is your overseas exporter of the machine, he will accept XYZ and Bureau Veritas will be removed from there and XYZ has to come in. Provided XYZ is a participant of the blockchain, because the damn thing will be issued from the blockchain. And it will be also a part of the negotiable instrument document for making the payment by a banking system based on all the documents of shipment. Right, have you understood the point? It's clear. Okay. So what are the features of a blockchain? That's the question I asked you. The features of a blockchain is that it is self-reliant. It is trustworthy. It is self-documented. It is safely preserved. It is having backup evidences. Doctor will say that during the course of anesthesia, I have given so much of anesthetic drug because the blood pressure is so much, because the blood sugar is so much, because the guy had an earlier history of asthmatic patient like me, the guy had a history of 3 operations earlier. So take all this taken together, I have given. Suppose the patient dies on the operation table and there is a claim on the hospital and it has been identified that the anesthetic drug was wrongly administered. The gentleman who has done the, or lady who has done the anesthetic drug administration, he or she has got complete documentation done in the backup evidences and plead that she is not guilty of negligence. Then quickly authorized. Cost savings without physical lawyers. You guys are out. Regulation compliant. IRDA regulations compliant. So if this is the feature, this is the set of features we have, then what is this? It is first, good quality, limited case of scope of changing and ambiguity, and cross-border transactions. Take the case, the contract which will be happening between the US surgeon, me as a patient, and the surgeon who is there, it will cross-border, it will be a cross-border smart contract. So the healthcare system requirement law of America, this guy is guided by that, he is not guided by Indian law. So the smart contract which will be adopted or embedding into the system will be compliant with the US Surgeon's Code of Conduct vis-a-vis Indian Code of Conduct. Because we are expecting that US will be much harder. Okay, so here is a case of cross-border smart contract. Now, what is a superset of smart contract? A superset of smart contract is, in this healthcare system, insurance is a contract, hospital is a contract, medicine is a contract, pathology is a contract, surgeon is a contract, and foreign surgeon is a contract. So many smart contracts are getting executed for one knee transplantation operation, right? So each smart contract are by themselves an individual self-sufficient standalone contract. Is that correct? When I do litigate with the doctor, I did not take the insurance company to Supreme Court. So the beauty of this contract is that the entire contract need not be exposed for any litigation purpose. The subcontract, which is a subset of the superset of contracts, can be taken for litigation purpose. Point clear? Understood? Okay. Very interestingly, People's Supreme Court of China has accepted the internet-based cases where it is done, has accepted the data drawn from blockchain as acceptable evidences. You think of a country which about 135 odd billion population, if they accept a blockchain-based data and documents as a sufficient evidence at their country or in their country, I'm sure all of the world will accept it in future. Now, you lawyers will not leave me alone like that, right? You will say, I want to test whether all the 9 guiding principles of an acceptable contract is passed by a blockchain which you have so far discussed. Now, you read these 9 bullets quickly and see whether if I comply with these 9 bullets, surely this is what I talked to you earlier when I wrote this poem. We'll break at 11:30. Essential conditions for an offer and acceptance to be converted into a binding contract, right? Now, so the discussion which I had done with you so far about that healthcare blockchain, this is satisfying, is that correct? So a digital contract can be enforceable under the Indian Contract Act, also can be enforced with the bilateral. Suppose this surgeon gave me the wrong instruction, which is video recording. If it is proved under the US healthcare system, the doctor has gone beyond his ethics and professional responsibility. Sitting in India, having the jurisdiction of court in India, I can sue this doctor in Indian courts. Provided the jurisdiction was not said to be America, jurisdiction was said to be Indian court. Or maybe International Court of London. So, you as a blockchain service provider, you are in a position to decide your blockchain based contract the manner in which you want to. Now, suppose the question you raise, flexibility. For one agreement, there can be, suppose the agreement with this guy. You can say agreement model 1, agreement model 2, agreement model 3. In agreement model 1, you have that the court of jurisdiction US, agreement model 2 court of jurisdiction India, or it could be agreement model 3, this is the clause which has flexibility, you select the clause. There is only one agreement, but the clauses where flexibility is required, you have been given the clauses option 1, option 2, option 3. The moment you select the option, it gets embedded into the main contract and that becomes your executable contract. So you have no intermediation. At least he or she can hire you and say, मुझे पढ़ के बताओ कि कौन सी ऑप्शन लेना है. right? You are with me. Has the talk so far made any sense?
Yes.
For you as well, yes. Okay, fine. I'm happy about it. So the whole word, yes.
Sir, now with respect to the final execution of such contracts, so, is it only based on the privacy of the parties or digital signatures of their parties?
Let me tell you, when I'm entering into the blockchain, I'm logging into from my device, I'm logging with my private key. And my KYC is there in the system. The moment I log in, a signal gets into the blockchain which is cryptographed. The system de-encrypts and gets to know what is this private key and then picks up the public key of mine allotted by the blockchain and stops using the private key in future. So you are completely a, you call pseudo anonymity. Okay, so you are not known except where there is a need for a physical touch point by the hospital, pathologist and the doctor. Okay. So, regarding cryptocurrency, which is the first ever use of blockchain technology by Satoshi Nakamoto and his team, I recently met one of the team members of Satoshi Nakamoto in Hyderabad. He came here. So, the Securities Exchange Commission of US has appointed a lady called Valerie Shepanik, if I can pronounce this correctly. She has been asked to study whether in the cryptocurrency based blockchain technology, the agreement which are embedded, whether those are sufficient and can a smart contract serve the purpose of capital asset transactions or value payment transactions. And she has said, and she is one of the, or is supposed to be one of the most famous lawyers of US, she has said yes, it is possible. Blockchain can be a solution for smart contract, and smart contract can be a solution for blockchain. They will supplement and complement each other. Okay, so this is what is the position so far as the world is concerned. While in US a lot of things are happening which I'll share with you, China has already commented. Okay, now you can ask me how the insurance company knows or doesn't know that I am a terrorist. Before insurance company gives me an insurance contract for my health care. Now that means every blockchain system for any solution in the world has to have its own KYC. Is that correct? And which is a very cumbersome process, very costly process, time consuming process, lot of documents have to be loaded. Because without KYC, I will not, if I don't know you, I will not allow you to come into my system. That's correct? Right now. So IBM has come out with a very interesting solution. IBM has said that all the blockchains of the world, may it be birth certificate, may it be healthcare, may it be supply chain, may it be disaster management, may it be anything, guys can first come into my system for KYC, and this blockchain will interact with the IBM's KYC blockchain. And without doing the additional KYC, they can adopt. Now you can say, in this given example, you can say when I am using this American surgeon, he has entered into the KYC of IBM according to American rules of KYC. Now this guy has to come into this blockchain which is operated from India. Whether Indian KYC rules and the American KYC rules are same, could be no, could be yes, could be there are some additional requirement of Indian blockchain solution for KYC as per Indian regulation. So the IBM is trying to understand that I will be creating KYC systems in my one single blockchain which will operate all over the world, where people can come in and do the KYC for their requested purpose. And this blockchain will then interact with this blockchain for adopting this guy into their system. So this is called interoperability of two blockchains. One blockchain is only for KYC, the other blockchain is for healthcare, and IBM is giving you a solution that a guy who is KYC compliant in my system, if he has to do an additional KYC for India, let him do. And once he does it, you are straight away adopted into the system. He did not do any KYC for any other purpose. The issue here, which is getting solved, is that you as a blockchain operator, if you have to develop your own KYC layer of your system, it is again expensive. Instead, you pay a very nominal fee to the IBM blockchain layer for KYC, and you are done. The biggest beneficiaries of this IBM blockchain would be BFSI sector. It will be increased speed, reduced cost, reduced risk, and enhanced experience. That is going to happen if this takes place. Now you can tell me, Dr. Basu, up to hawa mein patang ura rahe. Abhi main makar sankranti mein ura hai, aap bahut hawa mein ura rahe. Kya ho raha hai? Ye sab possible hai ki nahi? The answer is, it is possible. I interacted with some guys from Microsoft and IBM in Moscow and Dubai. Dubai also, I chaired this event. They are saying that these guys are developing some smart contract libraries, like healthcare smart contract, like supply chain smart contract, like port management smart contract, exchange smart contract, insurance smart contract. They are like, you have SAP. You take the SAP, customize a little bit for your own business requirements, and plug and play. Similarly, these people are trying to develop some library. Coming to this organization, IDACB. IDACB is a Russian organization. It's called International Decentralized Association of Cryptocurrency and Blockchain. This organization is an organization at the moment is of 95 countries of the world. I was interacting, of course there was an interpreter in Russia. One of the chief executives of IDACB was in my candle discussion session. He was sharing with me, they are doing three simple things. One thing they are doing is that they are trying to understand the basic principles the crypto world and the blockchain based business transaction world should follow worldwide. You know, there is one standard in the world which, without even a comma and full stop, followed by the world, all the 193 or 194 countries of the world follow. Which is that standard? Can anyone tell me? Can anyone tell me which is the standard or code followed by all the countries of the world without any change in comma and full stop? It is Civil Aviation Code. आप एयरपोर्ट से कैसे एयरक्राफ्ट को फ्लाई कराओगे, कैसे उसको लैंड कराओगे और कैसे एयरक्राफ्ट फ्लाई करेगा? The whole is one civil aviation contract of the world. It is much more stricter than IFRS. No option. Okay. So they are trying to find out similar such code of conduct which can be adopted for cross-border blockchain-based transaction applications. They are trying to understand the laws of all the countries of the world so that there can be a best practice evolution from all the contracts of the world. And they are also trying to understand all the regulators of the world, their regulation, so that there can be one single regulation for international transactions involving blockchain based on a followed standard code. Okay. Now, whatever I have discussed so far have been captured in these 12 points. You read it and try and gather. These are the attractions of blockchain as a solution from the perspective of a lawyer. This slide I have specially created for you.
Transactions are portal to portal based transactions.
Portal to node to node based.
Yeah.
Not portal. Portal is something different. It is your computer to other computer. Portal is a third party system in some way.
Exactly. Yeah. So there is no third party involved between the transaction. So when the traceability is concerned of the transaction, it cannot be traced for a very long time, and the transaction is done through the blockchain. So
it is just completely opposite. I'll tell you why. When you are doing a blockchain based transaction, there are thousands of parties. Suppose party number 99 and party number 799, the transaction has been conducted. This transaction, when it was initiated by party number 99, it was known to all the thousand parties in the blockchain. And when 799th party accepted the transaction, it was also announced to the blockchain. And this transaction, which is now with a hashtag attached to the block, is now sitting in the computing system of all the nodes. That's why there is a complaint against blockchain that its carbon footprint is very high, because one transaction is affecting all the thousand computers, and thousand computers is switched on. So electricity consumption is very high. So I have recently written my thought paper refuting this charge that blockchain technology is a green technology. I'll come to that later. But the point you have made, that it is traceability is an issue, absolutely not problem.
So because blockchain transactions are also used through in cryptocurrency, so a lot of cryptographic transactions have not been able to trace because they are through different
I'll
blocks
come to this
throughout the world.
After break, I'll come to this in greater detail, yes. The entire thing is confidential.
So right now you said the traceability is very easy, the carbon footprint thing, and it's
carbon footprint is a different
thing. It's accessible to all the parties in the blockchain.
Yeah.
So how can you execute a confidential agreement, a non-disclosure, like how can you
do? Okay, let's take the example that an insurance company need to know whether this could be whether 10 tests have been completed before this operation was done, right? The insurance company will be shown a list of tests done by the pathology clinic for this guy. But insurance company has accepted a smart contract that it will never ask for more than that information, that what were the results of that pathological test, which will be accessible by the doctors, because they need to have that for the administration of the treatment. Similarly, in a confidential contract, if the contract is such that, like the suppose Bureau Veritas has been appointed for a very unique technology which is embedded in the machine, which only knows by the importer and the exporter, because the technology for the first time. Okay, and I have paid a TKF for you. So now the banking system, and this is a confidential contract between you and me, and I have to remit TKF, technological know-how fee, to the foreign party, and also import the machines I have to pay. The banking system has agreed that they will be confirmed that whether the TKF has been executed, yes or no. But what were the contents of the TKF? If they want to download the contents of the TKF from the documentation system, it will not be possible, because that is accessible by the two parties. Clear? So what is required to be showed to you is on a concept called need to know basis, and need to know has been mutually agreed when you have signed the smart contract. Clear?
So
yeah.
So how is it that country and China
is
considering how Ireland
and India? That is beauty. That is what they are convinced about the. Maybe, have you understood the answer I have given to our question? Confidentiality comes when Partho need not to know what I have in my contract. To the extent Partho need to know, suppose 20 contracts in that particular, 20 clauses in that particular contract is confidential. Balance 80 clauses of that contract has to be known by rest of the parties, because those are required for their delivery of the services or in verification. The contract will be exposing only 80 clauses, and these 20 clauses will be a subset of the super contract, which will be kept confidential, and it will be tagged to each other. So let me tell you, the questions and anxieties you are expressing is still an issue, because smart contract is something which is pioneering the progress of blockchain technology, no doubt about it. But solutions are needed. Okay, so shall I move? Yeah. Yeah. Another 2 minutes. I'm a very hard teacher.
Okay.
If I have said 11:30, it means 11:30. Okay. So have you read this? You're clear? Okay. Now this I'm not going to cover because this is a partial picture of what I've covered here. Would you like to see the film and go? Or would you like to see the film and go? Because you are little. Nishit Deshai and associates have opened a very spacious wing under a senior lawyer for drafting smart contracts. And I have met them in TIMS conference where I presented a paper on blockchain, which is there in YouTube also. I specifically asked them, do you think smart contract is really doable? And the answer came, yes, it is doable. It has to be made doable. I'll give you the world scenario very quickly. In 2018, early 2018, PwC did a quick survey of blockchain technology of 600 executives with 18 countries, 18 regions of the world. 84% of these 600 people said that they are in some engagement with the blockchain. 45% said that the trust will be an issue. And this trust issue I'll be dealing with you very shortly because blockchain has been very badly marred by the evils of cryptocurrency, not evils of cryptocurrency, but evils of the people who deal with cryptocurrency. 30% have said that China will take the leader's role about blockchain technology development. And interoperability of blockchain is going to be an issue. Suppose in this whole system, none of you have asked me how the payment will be made. Now, Ethereum is a blockchain technology who have their own cryptocurrency. But the world is saying that without cryptocurrency, bank blockchain can work. The blockchain I am developing in Bangalore for my client, we are trying now to take out a file from here and share it with the bank for making and receiving the payment. So without a cryptocurrency, a blockchain technology can function. So this is the engagement pattern of the people. And what is the stage where they are? 14% are nowhere, like 84. Research stage, 20% of the organization. Post-research development stage, 32%. Pilot, 10%. And 15% of 600 organizations are on blockchain. I know a company in Switzerland who won the prize in Moscow conference. They have converted their brick and mortar industry into blockchain. So this blockchain is live in operations in many, many companies, many countries. At the moment, US is leading the show. 29% of the world blockchain developments is US today. And by 2023, China will go from 18% to 30% of blockchain applications. But US will be relegated down to 18%. After US and China, the guys who are in blockchain is only Australia, way beyond 7.7 to 8%, whereas 13 and 18, it is only 7 and 8%. India's position is 5% to 6%. So that's the position of the world and the blockchain today. Because of this 45% issue, this is creating a huge problem. But you have seen the WEF research that almost $10 trillion of transactions will be done by blockchain by 2027. Who are the industries which are working on blockchain? Financial services 46%, manufacturing industry 12%, energy 12%. In fact, today I have tweeted, today morning I have tweeted, my handle is @PuritasBasu. Blockchain technology will be used for effective and efficient utilization of power without any loss. Healthcare 11%, government 8%, retail and consumer 4%. You may be knowing that Andhra Pradesh government is having a huge problem of using underground water for irrigation by farmers, and farmers are abusing underground water, and in Punjab underground water is a menace. So blockchain technology will be used for underground water management with a particular payment, and nobody will be able to use it without any payment and without any quota allocation. Retail consumer 4% and entertainment and media industry is 1%. You may be knowing that Netflix, which you are seeing almost every day, has started using blockchain technology and artificial intelligence in a very, very deep way. Okay, so this slide you can't read, neither I can read. This particular slide has been developed by Deloitte. If you want to use blockchain technology, how do you decide? Dr. Basu comes to an industry and tells Srini, here is a blockchain technology, please use it. And he creates a hype. Would you like to succumb to his hype because he is a fatherly figure? Answer is no. I don't know whether I'm a fatherly figure or a terrorist. That's a different thing. But any consultant can come and say to use it. So EY has come out with a beautiful 5-question test. Very beautiful 5-question test. And I will elaborate this test. If any 3 of these answers are yes, then blockchain technology is your solution. First question, are there multiple parties in the ecosystem? Here. Is establishing trust between all the parties an issue? Here. Is it critical to have a detailed transactional record of activity? Here. Are we securing the ownership of management of a finite source? Here. And here the finite source is the finite source of services from various parties in the system. Does the network of partners benefit from increased transparency across the ecosystem? There is always a litigation between you and the insurance company that your bill has been underpassed, always gone. So is healthcare system susceptible to blockchain, or blockchain should be used for healthcare system? Answer is yes. So you do 5 tests. Here is IBM. There is a hoopla created all over the world about blockchain is this, blockchain is that, blockchain is truth machine, blockchain is what not. IBM has created a paper for which reference I have given here. All these are based on research of mine. All this tells you that blockchain is not a hoopla. When you read this paper, reflect on the points, blockchain is not a hoopla. Blockchain is not a hype. Blockchain is not equal to Bitcoin. Bitcoin failure, Bitcoin volatility is not because of blockchain. That is because of something else, which I'm going to share with you very soon. So this right thing within a green circle suggests that blockchain is here to stay. This again a decision tree. By applying these two, whether you will ultimately decide to go for blockchain, you can test it here. This itself will take about half an hour to explain. I don't want to explain to you. You can reflect, and you guys need not know much about it, but at least for generating the smart contract, you should be knowing about it. This is again a blockchain evolution cycle. Again, everything has an infancy stage. Everything has a stage of childhood, everything has a stage of advancing, and everything has a stage of full maturity. Blockchain is now at the moment, mostly those 15% cases are here, and rest of the cases which you saw, the PWC's adolescence case. The issue is when full maturity will come. Full maturity will come when one blockchain system will interoperable with the other blockchain system. Many of you may not be knowing that Indian ports are managing blockchain, and blockchain system is used by Indian ports for berthing of ships. Suppose in Vizag, a ship has come, and Vizag doesn't have berth available, whereas Madras port is having a place available for such a big ship to get berthed. Through blockchain, the port manager of Vizag comes to know whether Madras can take this particular ship. So they have already started partial application of blockchain technology. It's not in advanced stage. Now you can ask me, sir, this is a very complex technology, very complex algorithm. Why do I have time to do all these things and then start my blockchain? You need now. Today, there are 9 sources available: Ethereum, Hyperledger, Multi-Chain, Ultra-Chain, Open-Chain, IBM, Unix, Blockchain, Chain, and IOTA. These are the organization which has got SAP-type ERP, SAP-type blockchain. It's not a plug-and-play blockchain, of course. You adopt that code and then customize it for your purpose of application and use it. Some of them are open source, free of cost. Some of them are commissioned, and some of them are paid. The best of them is Hyperledger Fabric, which is being utilized by a lot of people for application of blockchain, which is an IBM blockchain platform. And let me ask you one question. Organizations like IBM, Cognizant, Morgan Stanley, if they are investing billions of dollars in blockchain, are they fools? Okay, we'll see this video provided time is there, but let me skip for time. We'll talk about the myth. Blockchain myth will demystify. Is blockchain really a myth or a reality? Let us talk about it. First of all, people say that blockchain is equal to Bitcoin and Bitcoin is equal to blockchain. Like when somebody goes to a petrol pump and says, "Gari me thoda mobile dal do," is he asking for mobile or is he asking for lubricating oil? He's asking for lubricating oil, right? He's not asking for mobile. Mobile is a brand of a lubricating oil. Similarly, blockchain has become synonymous to Bitcoin or cryptocurrency because the cryptocurrency of Bitcoin is the very first usage of blockchain technology, right? So this is what is in the mind of people because they have not seen it as yet, any application. Like when WWW came, Sabir Bhatia came out with WWW, everybody thought that that is only for using mail exchange, right? Today, and WWW is nothing but internet, right? Today you are using internet to draw food from some hotel, right? Zomato and Swiggy works on what? WWW. You are hailing a taxi through internet, right? You don't even know that internet you are using for hailing a taxi. The same thing is with blockchain. People don't know what is blockchain. People have not seen a man in the street doesn't know what is blockchain. So the man on the street will understand what is blockchain when you start using this, right? So the issue here is that blockchain is not internet, is Bitcoin. Bitcoin is not blockchain. Blockchain has got hundreds and more applications. Reason for what has happened to Bitcoin. You know, Bitcoin or any cryptocurrency, in a blockchain, if you want to participate, you have to participate on your own in the public key and private key. But as an investor, when you are investing in Bitcoin and cryptocurrency, like share you buy from share market through brokers, the Bitcoin and the cryptocurrency trading is run through brokers. And these brokers, they have logged into the blockchain system, which is used for Bitcoin or Ethereum, any other cryptocurrency, and then they have done the transaction. Before doing the transaction, the system through which you interact with the exchange operator for cryptocurrency, in that system, a lot of fraud has taken place, and that system is not blockchain. Because you as an investor of the cryptocurrency, you have not logged into blockchain with your private key. Your broker has logged into private with your private key. So the broker has created the issue. That's why it is being said that human gluttony and ulterior motives of the exchange operators have created. And the SEC of America, US Justice Department and SEC is completely convinced. Authorities worry that virtual currencies are susceptible to fraud for multiple reasons. And none of these are blockchain. Skepticism that all exchanges are actively pursuing cheaters. Wild price swings that could make it easy to push valuations around a lack of regulations like the ones that govern stocks and other assets. Blockchain, if you are a Bitcoin investor, in your quote you are using a Bitcoin gold plate. Why? You are showing how you are a digital currency. it has become like one blood plane hanging from your pocket. It has become a society's listing. This guy is a cryptocurrency owner. So that is the case. People are, for their ultra societal status, is creating havoc in the cryptocurrency and Bitcoin life. You see the US situation, in the entire US is divided. In SEC says that cryptocurrency is a security. CFTC is Commodity Future Trading Commission of America. They say that cryptocurrency is a property. FinCEN, which is Financial Crime Enforcement Center of US, they say that cryptocurrency is a currency. And IRS, Internal Revenue Service, they say that this is a property. So there are four supreme authorities in America. They are themselves divided in their own opinion whether it is a property, whether it is a security, or whether it is a currency. Australia has said that cryptocurrency is a commodity, so they are applying GST on it. UK has said that it is a currency. But Japan is saying that cryptocurrency will allow for transaction, but it will not be a national currency. And India government is already working on introducing digital currency in India. And blockchain for that purpose has already been tested, tried and kept ready with the help of ICICI Bank. So the best of the best regulators of US is divided in their view. Whether it is a property, so you will apply Stamp Act on exchange, whether it is a goods, or whether you will apply GST, or whether it is a currency, whether you will apply exchange rates, America doesn't know. So that's the situation of cryptocurrency in the world. Okay, so in America, a lot of Harvard scholars are talking about that the regulator, the market players, and the financial institution, they should come together and work for some regulations to be enacted by the parliament and senate. So this work is going on. I tell you, there is a slide on this. But meantime, guys in Africa, who are the most poor states, are making best use of blockchain. There is a country called Kenya who is using a software called 4G Capital as a company, software called ADAPP. If you read this particular slide and particular website, you will find the poorest of the poor traders, poorest of the poor small business people are being helped by a blockchain-based technology platform for P2P funding of money. Bankers are not there in the picture. I being in HNI, you are running a vegetable shop, I fund you. As you know, in India, only 3% is the NPA in microfinance, whereas 12% in the NPA is in most macrofinance of the world. That is the irony of the world. So the beauty of this particular application, and you'll be very happy to know, that it is, as you know, any website you use for any purpose, content is your website, which is done in any format. Then you have API and your database. That is your standard website. In DAPP, the front end is again a normal website which you use. The interface between the data blockchain and the front end is a smart contract. And the back end is a blockchain. So when a poor country like Kenya has started using blockchain technology for P2P funding, why can't India do it? Keto, you know Keto? Huh? Kapoor, what is his name? He is running, running crowdfunding. This is crowdfunding through blockchain technology. Okay, so these are some of the pictures of use cases of blockchain which I have captured here. You will find there are 36 line items are there in which blockchain technology has been utilized, 36 line items. Each line item should be having a back multiplier of 3 to 5 use cases. So about 150 odd use cases have already been found through application of blockchain technology. And you'll be surprised to know, one of the use cases will be applied by jails, which are known as correction houses. Jails will be using blockchain technology for correction houses of criminals to be monitored in terms of their correction stage from their criminal mind, and for which AI will be used. I've just named one. Now come to the applications. PwC and World Economic Forum has done a research. They have found the 80 different types of natural calamities and biodiversity management can be done by using blockchain. You'll be surprised to know that the Great Barrier Reef of Australia, which I visited, is getting worse because of the heat of the ocean under ocean bed water. Blockchain technology will be used for connecting it, and for that fish type robots have been already invented, and these fish type robots will get through the water and correct temperature, and through IoT inform the blockchain that this is the temperature of this particular zone, because GPS will be used, of this particular zone of the Great Barrier Reef, and government will get to know whether it is atmospheric temperature which is heating up the water, or any sheep or anything which is heating up the water, and take corrective actions. So natural calamities can be handled through blockchain. The Nursing Association of Europe has said that we'll be using blockchain technology for reaching our nursing services to the patients, that are approaching us and not getting the nursing services. The Football Club of Madrid, they will be using blockchain technology for payment, for performance payments to their football players, and also for management of these fanatic supporters in the stadium, for management of tickets. US Naval Agency will be using blockchain technology for movement of spare parts, which is very critical for their airports and naval operating system throughout the world. Food chain, Carrefour and Walmart, etc. As you know, any Michael Kors bag you are buying, or any Reebok shoe you are buying, there is a chance of 25% of those items are fake. Blockchain technology, in our school, two students are working on blockchain technology application for tracking and tracing any product from the manufacturer to the ultimate user through blockchain technology. It is possible. They have done the use case. Same is being used by Canadian government for marijuana, all drugs. And India, already in Hyderabad, an organization called Asli Medicine has already developed a blockchain-based technology for ensuring that medicines are not fake. As you may be knowing that 30% of medicines used in India are fake medicines. Blockchain will be used. Another interesting news for professors. Several academicians of Oxford University has opened on their own a blockchain university. Only blockchain will be taught in that university, and 2019 teaching will start. That is very soon the teaching will start. And that is the blockchain university. And these are my tweets, which you can see some of my photographs here coming. So what is the, these are private initiatives are happening. What is the government doing in various countries? Some of the very recent applications of what government is doing, I'll be sharing with you. The newly elected Prime Minister of Australia, Scott Morrison, he has committed that Australian government will be all there for blockchain technology. IBM blockchain is trying to handle the humanitarian issue of blockchain. Like you remember, Chris Fabi and I have shared with you the United Nations guy. IBM has promised that through a new blockchain software called Humanity, they will only use this blockchain technology for solving the problems of the poorer sections of the society. This is a European regulation, particularly France. European Parliament and Committee of Research and Industry and Energy passed the blockchain resolution, including sections for ICO offering. So Europe has made ICO offering a legally valid position. This is South Korea. South Korea is considered to be the most friendly countries amongst the world countries for blockchain technology. And their government has said that we are going to commit huge funds for blockchain technology to be given a booster and use. And this is their second minister of science and ICT, Wong Kee. He has talked about this. I've given all the proofs by giving the websites. This is a guy from America. In America, three laws are being enacted. One is for blockchain, one is for regulations of blockchain technology, and next is for cryptocurrency related regulations. In America, this is being done. In France, a separate legislation has been passed for ICO and cryptocurrency. France wants to be the leader of cryptocurrency. In India, as you know, Switzerland has already accepted cryptocurrency based on that. This is Parliament of Chile. Parliament of Chile has recently announced that they will be using blockchain technology in a big way for government services delivery to their citizens. As you know, in India, Telangana and Andhra Pradesh government has already opened a number of agencies in these two states for blockchain-based technology, particularly when they are thinking that Vizag will be a smart city. A smart city cannot operate without blockchain, and Dubai has announced by 2020, Dubai will be the happiest city of the world, and their entire system will be run by 20 blockchain platforms. One of them has already started, that is the payment platform. This is the seven new countries near the Mediterranean region. They have already said that we'll be using blockchain in a big way. So, point you are trying to perhaps understand from me, or I'm trying to make you understand, that blockchain as a technology is one side being looked at by people like IBM, Cognizant, Microsoft, and world of consulting organization, PwC, Deloitte. On the other side, the government initiatives are coming one by one to come in together. And in between, there is an organization called IBACEI of Russia, who are trying to make a bridge of all the nations together to bring in an international civil aviation type code of standards for applications in cryptocurrency and blockchain. Now, you as a lawyer will say, sir, all these are rubbish. I'm not going to accept any blockchain-based transaction unless it is on it. Right? Like any financial statement, you as a lawyer will not give any cognizance unless it is audited by a third party, right? So any blockchain transaction has to be audited, right? Like somebody was trying to make me understand money laundering is possible, or over-invoicing or under-invoicing is possible to blockchain. Yes, it is possible. What is the deterrent for that? Is audit. So this particular few slides I have developed particularly for you. And also the AIIP conference I did recently. What is happening in the world? If you reflect on this slide, this is the universe of your business risk. Your business risk, your external risk, your financial risk, your operational risk, and your governance and strategy related risk. And these have been summed up by me in this particular slide. Now, you have to test all these risks which are there in your system, whether blockchain can address these risks. That's the job. Blockchain will be an acceptable transaction processing platform only when one perspective of risk management, which also includes governance management, thus also includes compliance management, is done by blockchain, right? That's the idea. You're with me. Blockchain has to, you as lawyers will accept if this contract is compliant with all the relevant laws. You as lawyers will also accept whether my client is risk managed. So instead of managing the risk on a reactive manner, blockchain has to manage the risk in a proactive manner. Is that correct? What is the world doing? Let us understand that. Here is a very interesting news item. Big Four, Deloitte, EY, KPMG, and PwC are joining a group of 20 banks in Taiwan, and it is as old as only 6-7 months, July 19, 2018, are joining a group of 20 banks in Taiwan to trial a blockchain service for auditing public companies' interim financial reports. Interim financial reports, which are quarterly financial statements in India as per SEBI regulations, blockchain will be used for testing those. What a beauty. And all Big Fours are behind it. Okay, now I'll tell you what Big Fours are doing regarding blockchain-based audit. This is matrix. Business, you have a 4x6 matrix. Business objective, this matrix is for each manager. Business objectives, core processes, supporting functions, risk consideration, and operating model components. In a business, there are 6 operating model components. Governance and oversight, policies and standards, management processes, here are the main operations, tools and technology, risk matrices and reporting, and finally risk culture. In this, there is an element called smart conduct. You can't read the Greek portion. I can't do anything about it because this is a wasted picture. Smart contract and risk consideration. This portion Deloitte has specifically identified for risk mitigation measurement, whether the workflows are embedded in smart contracts. The Deloitte has said that although blockchain is in the agenda, top 3 agenda of the CEO and CFO, yet at the same time the main crisis of the world is that many people don't know what is blockchain. What is blockchain? Nobody knows. So lack of knowledge is a very big issue. So risk management has to be that much tighter so that the lack of knowledge is taken care of. So it's a 4x6 risk matrix which Deloitte has developed for working on blockchain-based transaction management and transaction audit. PwC is doing a very, very good job. PwC has again accepted all the points which Deloitte has said. PwC has said that no standard way to validate a blockchain-based business processes because there is a unique control environment. Blockchain environments have unique architecture and standardization. Each client must design a customized control system. Lack of knowledge, traditional audit techniques will not apply, and blockchain environment are real time. Because every transaction is real time, and those are immutable transactions. Nothing can be corrected by rewriting this. Everything is done. So what to do? So PwC has done a very good job. PwC has developed a software. This software are a little flexible in terms of configuring the software for testing blockchain-based technologies, transactions. And they are building these features of that. It is a real-time feature. There's a built-in audit pickup post another part of the system. Just another part of the system. That means when the transaction is being done in blockchain, as you are saying, that if the guy is this guy is overquoting, then the standard rate accepted by insurance company, then the insurance company can raise a flag that the price is overquoting more. So every damn thing, PwC is developing a software in such a manner that the client will be applying that software into their blockchain technology-based transactions, and the software will start giving signals on a real-time basis whether the transaction is going as per the audit norms or not. That is what PwC is claiming that they have done. And my personal request and submissions, which I am speaking in various blockchain technology platforms, including overseas countries, that such a powerful tool is prone to be abused and prone to be misused. So there has to be an international civil aviation standard-like rule for developing blockchain-based platform. And for that, multilateral organization like WTO or United Nations, they should be given blockchain-based contract standards. Or OECD countries, as you know. Like we have standard contracts for double taxation treaties, right? Similarly, we should be having standards, methodologies for configuration of the blockchain technology platform where the commercial, non-commercial, charity, and government service related transactions will be done. So PwC is doing a very good job so far this is concerned. Coming to Ernst & Young is almost working on the same style of developing certain tools of reviewing blockchain based transactions. But one thing is PwC not doing, Ernst & Young is not doing, is that their tool is at the moment only for capital assets and liability, financial assets and liabilities. they are trying to develop something which is going to work for all the other types of blockchain transactions which they have developed as yet. KPMG is going to use cognitive technology. And you know cognitive technology is what? Artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, these are cognitive technologies. KPMG has adopted big data analytics as a method. So KPMG's audit system would be, they will go to the back end of blockchain and apply AI tools for understanding whether the transactions which have been done in the blockchain system is having a proper trail in which the transactions have been created. They'll be doing the analytics to know, helping to do the things right. So they will apply analytics of the client's transaction to understand whether the clients are doing the right thing. And they will be using the cognitive technology for understanding from their blockchain-based transaction whether the clients are doing the right thing in the right way. So helping to do the things right, helping do the right things. So as long as you are in a position to establish through your audit tool that you are doing the right thing in the right way, your audit is acceptable to you lawyers, right? Now, am I talking sense? Okay, fine. So, risk management technology, which you do, can it be like this? Can it be like this, risk management technology? If anything happens, can you apply a safety pin? But if you apply a safety pin for your wardrobe malfunctioning, if there is a pressure, the safety pin will start tearing the rest of the portion of your cloth. So safety pin is not a correct technology. Okay. It has to be properly structured. You have seen the human pyramids during Govinda time in Bombay, keeps falling down. Even three attempts they cannot form the pyramid because it is not properly structured. The distribution of balance of weight is not right from the top of the pyramid to the bottom of the pyramid. The blockchain technology perhaps will be able to do this better than even SAP in future. Blockchain technology identifies the weakest link in the chain. And I do not know, Shoini, I will make a statement which will be perhaps acceptable to your students or not, that the biggest litigation in the world has come from documentation and not the operation, am I right? Documentation is the biggest source. Once I document a contractual patho, and if I could overpower patho and then do according to the contract, I will be going to the court and say, this is what is the contract says, that is what I have done, these are the evidences, why Partho has a litigation with me. But whether the contract Partho has done with me, it is totally one-sided and based on principle of equity or not, I do not know. Because Partho's lawyer was weak and my lawyer was strong. Because there was an intermediation. Here nothing is available. Here it is, everything is based on smart contract. So smart contracts attacks the weakest link of the chain in the business system of the country. And finally, domino effect. Every system of the world which has been developed so far in digital world says that if I protect the front end, nobody will be getting into the back end. But if the front end is pierced, the back end is also pierced through domino effect. Now I have explained to you in the first part of my talk that domino effect of hacking is not possible in blockchain. So the four weakest methodology of risk management, that is safety pin technology, unstructured processes, weakest link in the chain, and the domino effect, blockchain takes care of all of them. Okay, and this is the last section of my presentation. I think I will be able to keep a lot of time for question and answer. Human dimensions of blockchain technology. This is what I love the most. This is where I bring a lot of spiritualism and a lot of imaginative thinking for you. This is what is my first paper on blockchain which I have already published. And my view is not human dimension, it is human dimension. Okay. This slide has become very, very popular in Moscow. A lot of people have quoted me throughout the conference summit on 2 days. I say, technology doesn't have morality, emotion, ethics, and technologists have. Success of blockchain will depend on those human qualities of solution builders. As I said in the first, Bhagavad Gita has said that with might if you serve your mind, you are not worthy of doing good work. So it has to be with emotion, morality, and ethics. Success of blockchain will depend on those human qualities of solution builders, leaving least scope for the user to deploy against humanity with an ulterior motive. So ulterior motives will be there in the humanity. The blockchain's job would be to leave in least possible scope to apply. Now these 7 T's and 7 P's which I have suggested for building blockchain technology with your human side of scientist personal character is 7 T's are technology. You must understand the technology, you must have talent, you must believe in truth, you must trust, you must have transparency, you must have tenacity to perfect the system till it is done, and you must do it in a timeline, otherwise you will never come up with this solution, it will be expensive for you. In order to do this, you should have 5, 6, 7 P's with you. You should be good people, you should have patience, you should have passion, you should have perseverance, you should have honesty, you should have purity, and finally, you should have penance. You should be punishing yourself if you do not do. Good job. So, if you are in Twitter with me, you will find a lot of, many times I tweet on this. So, we want dimension two. I want blockchain to be the darling of the mass. And www has become darling of the mass. You order your food, it's a darling. You are hungry, 7 minutes, 10 minutes, food is with you. So it is a darling. So it has to be on universal altruism. Altruism means something which is universally true for everybody. It should be possible through blockchain technology to share the value you create, $10 trillion value you create, it should be shared with the lowest rung of the society. And blockchain technologies cannot be a we-dev kind of a system. I cannot say, oh, I am a blockchain technologist, so I am a try. No. You can't be a try. You should be the harbinger of development shared with us for inclusive happiness. Breaking sovereign boundaries. WWW has broken the boundaries of the world, physical and geographical boundaries. No postman is required to reach a mail to your system we're studying in US, right? No postman is required. Physical boundaries have been broken. Blockchain has to break the sovereign political boundaries. Like if I have the benefit required for a US surgeon to participate in my knee surgery, I have to have the sovereign boundaries broken. In my smart contract, I should have the ability to pitch in the clauses which are required for an American surgeon to participate in my surgery. Blockchain has its own ism, irrespective of globalization and protectionism. Trump is going for protectionism. America told us what is globalization, right? Blockchain cannot be only globalization. Blockchain cannot be only protectionism. Blockchain should have blockchain. That's what is my suggestion. Blockchain must be having inclusive character. You know, many of the technologies, can you tell me SAP which has been developed, who has been benefited? Businessman, right? Business organization. How the SAP or Oracle Financial has directly benefited the lower rank of the society. But if for my son's birth certificate I have to go 10 times to the BDO's office, block development office, and am I 4 user, I can take it from my phone, my 7 times, 10 times visit and some bribe, I'm saving. I get my money against the MNREGA Mahatma Gandhi scheme, MNREGA scheme. I through blockchain technology I get my money. The underground water, Jisnipas Maitha, they are taking it out for the pump. I don't get water for my for farming of my land. So blockchain technology will have help. So blockchain has to help the lower rung of the society. Then only success will come to blockchain. Customers must acknowledge for self-initiating the contract. We've spoken quite a lot about it. Humanity is one, and the world is its home. is the need for a global regulatory body of blockchain. Like, why do you think that civil aviation standards are there? Because there is no frequent civil aviation accidents and loss of life. The same way, there should not be loss of value through blockchain. And that's why there should be a global regulatory body for blockchain application. Blockchain and IoT is very interesting. Tomorrow your refrigerator will order your food, right? Your vegetable requirement. That technology is getting developed. Okay, what is being done? It is a cognitive camera and cognitive IoT and a cognitive AI. These three things will be operating inside your refrigerator when you are working at office, and it will create an order to be placed on bigbasket.com for ordering a vegetable, right? That is what is IoT and cognitive technology will do. So what is being thought through in blockchain technology is that every single IoT of the world is on a centralized ledger. If some of the IoTs of the world can be put into the blockchain, it's a little technical, you may not be understanding it so properly. The decentralized ledger will be able to create much more benefit for IoT. One of the examples is of drone. Government of India has given the drone circular, drone policy, right? Now, how a civil aviation authority will control drone? Drones are continuously giving signals about their GPS positioning and how much time they have to land and release the aviation flight path, right? Which the aircrafts are doing today. This individual drone is an IoT, Internet of Things, right? Because all the information are being passed through internet, okay? Carrier is the spectrum, magnetic spectrum. So all these drones of a particular region, if it is put into a blockchain will be able to help it. Like today, when an aircraft flies, how the engine of the health is behaving, airlines company is not bothered. Because every engine has certain IoTs, and any flight it is taking, maybe a 45 minutes flight or a 19 hours flight to San Francisco from India, the engine is continuously sending signals through an IoT to the engine maker, either Airbus or Boeing, that this engine health is this way. This is the temperature of the engine, this is the RPM of the engine, this much of fuel it is consuming, etc. And from the information given, the engineers in a position through artificial intelligence to understand which spare part of the engine is not properly functioning. Think of all these things are happening on a decentralized manner through certain IoTs which are fitted into the aircraft engine. If those can be centralized, then international aviation safety can be much better. So that's what is being talked about in this technology regarding IoT. So I developed, again, this also has become very popular in Moscow. This is my own personal contribution to the world of management, is 7WH principle. 7WH principle. I request you to read it. This is 7WH principle of value generation, and blockchain should use it. If you read my second paper, you will get this. This has been published, available in a website on blockchain technology. So this, any technology which you develop, at the each stage of the development, you must ask yourself these 7 W's and 1 H. If you do answer properly in affirmative that yes, this is okay, then your technology also will be okay. So, this is an interesting slide. What you trust may not be true. and what you skew may not be what you trust. Blockchain technology's job is to ensure that what you trust is true, and what is true, that is only you trust. Right? Let me go one step ahead, do some proactive thinking, how the shape of things will come in Industry 5.0. Any one of you know what is Industry 5.0? Industry 5.0 is that industrial revolution where you will not be giving me any customized solution. You will be giving me a platform where I will go and customize my own unique solution requirement. Take the case of your grandmother. Your grandmother used to buy akha haldi, akha lal mirchi, akha jeera from kirana shops, and they used to piece out in home, right? After that, when your mother came, baby baki mother or homemaker, they get haldi powder, mirchi powder, jeera powder, dhania powder, right? They get. And now, when you will be going to your kitchen, what are you getting? Chana masala, butter chicken masala. You're getting, right? What these masala companies are doing? They are doing what you were doing previously. Your grandmother was doing piso, grinding. They started grinding themselves. Your mother was cooking it by having a proper chemistry of the masalas. Sometimes it is good, sometimes it is bad. So the chemistry part has been taken over, right? Now when you will come back from home and you want your husband wants butter masala, you want to cook butter masala, paneer butter masala, you just take out the paneer butter masala and put it in. What are you doing? Do what the customer does, right? So Industry 5.0 wants to be a digital solution where the customer will be able to customize its own requirement. That is Industry 5.0. So there cannot be one fit all size straitjacketed solutions for everything. Like many of you, if you ask me 10 permits, I'll give you many questions here which Industry 5.0 has to solve. It is still not very flexible as it should be. So Industry 5.0, I personally feel blockchain will be able to solve in a big way with a dear layer of data analytics, AI and machine learning. So I feel that Swarm Computing, you know about this computing, is WARM, Swarm Computing. Just check about it in Google. I think Swarm Computing will be helping blockchain along with deep learning and machine learning and AI to become a user-friendly item for Industry 5.0. So my last slide before I close with the comment from APJ Abdul Kalam is that believe in the ants. Ants can carry 20 times more their body weight, right? So don't challenge your limits. Limit your challenges, right? If you limit your challenges, you need certain tools, and blockchain is perhaps one of those tools. So I end my talk with the vision of APJ Abdul Kalam. He says, a vision is not a project report or a planned target. It is an articulation of a desired end result in broader terms. You cannot be undefined or unstructured or unarticulated in your vision. You should define it properly, then only you'll be able to execute it. So thank you so much. Now your questions. A little late, and the technology taking over took some time to need to start. And Shoni says that we have no time to spill over because some of you have and you have to go for your own internships. So now we can spend another 10-15 minutes for questions and answers. As many questions as you want. Phil, you want to see the film? Sure.
My question is that since there is no regulation,
contracts have been developed so far worldwide, the jurisdiction clause is very much there. Otherwise, you know, any smart contract which are getting drafted, I had a benefit of listening to a session where Abhishek Deshadai was addressing the gathering. Wherever you are developing any digital contract to be self-executed and self-initiated, the jurisdiction clause, all these standard clauses of a contract is very much there. Moreover, when you have a cross-border situation like this, the jurisdiction clause is very much there and KYC compliance is very much there. So that's a simple of the issues which needs to be solved. Any other question?
It needs to be implemented effectively. Is it that people are not aware of that, or is it because you need to be really tech savvy to understand what is happening?
In fact, in your question, you have answered certain things.
Yeah.
First of all, as I have said, that the common man on the street has not seen so far any application of blockchain technology which he or she can do through a phone. Okay, so blockchain technology is not a common knowledge as yet. Even in corporate houses, both Deloitte and PwC and KPMG have spoken in a vigorous way that it may be at the top of the agenda of the CXOs, but it is not in the training scheme as yet. In fact, I understand that EY has started a blockchain and AI-based training for auditing. So one of the biggest challenge is to train your staff. If you want to adopt blockchain technology, your staff training is the first important thing. People have to understand what is blockchain. The second and the most important factor is, are you going to work on a permissioned open source blockchain, which is paid or not paid, or you're going to work on your self-developed blockchain, which is self-coded. At the moment, my consulting firm is developing in Seoul and it's taking time. So if you do self-coding, you have to ensure that you have not left any, even a little hole for the people to take benefit out of that. So that little hole can be plugged if there is any international standard. So international standard, or at least some standard, has to be there. Now there is an argument against it that the blockchain technology was developed in the late 1990s. by Satoshi Nakamoto and his team. When the 2008 financial crisis came, then Satoshi Nakamoto and his team members thought that blockchain technology can be utilized for offering a solution to fiat currency, which is a physical currency controlled by banking system of any country. So they brought in a use case of peer-to-peer funding to virtual currency. But the issue is that there are a lot of things happened in that because of human greed and brutality and ulterior motives of people. So blockchain has got a bad side. 2014 and 2012, 13 and 14, around that time, a set of digital scientists started thinking of blockchain applications for some other purposes, both for government and for business purposes. Like exim contracts, blockchain is very popular, supply chain blockchain is very popular. You have very rightly pointed out that whether smart contract is going to be a biggest challenge, the answer is yes. That's why Palash Soini has organized this lecture, that you lawyers of tomorrow must be capable of understanding what is this digital platform is. And digital platform has to introduce self-initiated, self-executable, retrievable, evidence-oriented contract. Then you have to first understand the technology. So again, we are back to the square one, that you have to have a proper knowledge about the technology. The whole world is up in arms saying that blockchain technology is stabilizing. It has not stabilized as yet. So your point is very true, that in a situation where the technology itself is evolving, the natural process of learning by doing mistakes will take place. Technology will evolve. But it has been summarily been established that the technology is very powerful. I think by now in the class you are convinced that technology is very, very powerful. And lots and lots of billions and billions of dollars are getting invested into it. The last point of yours, smart contract. Yes, smart contract is the key issue. Smart contract is considered to be the place where the tire hits the road for a blockchain. Because at the end of the day, blockchain cannot be a decorated piece on your system, right? It cannot be another Bitcoin type badge on your jacket. It has to function. If it has to function, it has to function in a legally executable manner. And subsequently, any litigation can be handled through blockchain. Smart contract is really, really a challenge. And another challenge is flexibility building it into the smart contract. Like she asked the question of sovereignty. Now, if I have to build in the sovereign elements of US and India, and maybe my insurance company is a Japanese insurer, I can buy an insurance from Japan also, right? When I bring an operation in India, a Japanese insurer can insure my medical, right? Not even located in India, I can buy directly from Japan. So, in this kind of situation, a duly compliant smart contract with the all sovereign compliance CIGA and regulated requirements is a bit of a challenge. And this bit is a big bit. So, lot depends upon you, the lawyers of tomorrow. You develop. But I can assure you one thing, which is by open prophecy, that this is the future. Your brick and mortar, paper, pen and paper, word doc is not the future of contracts. Tomorrow, a lot of court decisions will be taken. 1 minute, I'm coming. Lot of judgments are being put into the digital systems to judge on a particular section of a litigation point. What is the worldwide judgment by lawyers? Because there is something called common law. So, a lot of research are going on, a lot of contributions are coming up. Recently, one of our MBA students, Rahul Sinha, has written his small paper on this. I wish, I encourage you to write a lot of papers on smart contract, bring out the issues on it. So, could I answer your question? Yes.
So, frankly, doesn't the block, with my limited understanding, the blockchain technology works on the assumption that anything and everything is put on the web in the first place, right?
No.
So, as a person who wants to go into litigation in the future, I would know that most people that I deal with will not be comfortable putting that information on the net in the first place. So when we say that we can execute normal contracts through smart contracts or make normal contracts as smart contracts or even have small issues, whether be it in a family, be it a real estate issue or anything like that, executed through the blockchain concept in the first place, if I am not comfortable putting it up there, how is it that this blockade can be tackled by technology? Because on one hand you have brick and mortar, you have pen and paper where secrecy is there, where you control who that thing goes to, and on the other, once you put it on your phone, once you put it on your laptop, honestly I don't think in today's time as a common man I have zero control over where that information gets used. My question is, how do we tackle this disparity? Because both can't go together, and even if one is working then the other can't function.
Okay, very good point. And did your father, when he opened his first bank account, ever thought that he will do 1 lakh worth of transactions through telephone?
Absolutely.
No. Has he put all his information into the digital system of the bank?
Yes.
Right? No? Has he stopped issuing checks to his cooperative society where monthly rental has to be paid? Yes, he should stop, right? I pay my cooperative society. So what we could not think of 20 years back is happening today. So what you are thinking today that it's not possible to be done in smart contract, it will be possible. Your question and your apprehension that the data security and privacy is not there. I met a guy from Johannesburg in Moscow. This guy is developing a matchbox type instrument. This instrument is having a Bluetooth and your phone. He presses certain buttons, his phone is on, and he phones doesn't know what are the numbers which have been pressed. Once the Bluetooth gets the signal, phone is on and the instrument goes off. So now this phone, without this instrument, who will hack? Can anybody get into the database of your phone? Can be hacked, right? It has been proven. Anybody without getting into your phone, hack your phone? No. Because of this small instrument, it has not become very successful and popular. That's a different thing. Coming to blockchain, data is there in this, or in your book, on your cloud computing, where you keep. Suppose your company is a blockchain-based company, supply chain management company. You are a local from factory to port service provider for transportation. You are participating in an exim blockchain. And you are doing a transaction getting into the blockchain from your system. The question is, can your system be hacked? Yes, your system can be hacked. But the portion where the blockchain technology-based platform is residing, that cannot be hacked. Because that is cryptographed. There is no personal identity of yours available. This is public key. And suppose this is hacked, can the entire data be vanished away? What is a hacker today? If hacker takes care of the insurance data of an insurance company in capture and say, you pay me $1 million, then only I'll hand over the data. Because tomorrow you cannot do transactions without this data. Because I have 10 million insured people's data with me. Tomorrow if any claims, you will not be able to handle it. Now the insurance company system being hacked for what? That insurance company gets back the data, and under that threat, $10 million have been taken. Here you hack the insurance company, no insurance, but another database where the same data is designing. You have seen the slide now where centralized data, decentralized data, and blockchain data. Cannot be done. Yes?
Yes, sir. So probably theft is not an issue, and it may not be as amenable to hacks. But when we talk about confidentiality or even privacy, so when we spoke about IBM and the blockchain that is trying to develop for KYC, so when all the KYC data will be on that blockchain, and if somebody is able to hack into that system, so although all the data won't be lost, but people who shouldn't have access to that KYC data will get access to that data.
Okay, let me explain to you what is the IBM principle, though I have not started their principle. But as you know, I have one invention of mine, which has been cleared by World Intellectual Property Organization, Switzerland. One invention of mine has been cleared, so I have some idea of digitals. So how this will operate? Let us take this is IBM blockchain, where millions of millions KYCs have been done. And suppose here you run an Exim blockchain, where you don't want to do KYC and you want these two systems to be interoperable. So I as an Exim blockchain, I don't want my KYC to be done by my system because I don't want it to be so heavy. You become an IBM blockchain KYC. Now I have, before I make my system and this system interoperable, I will examine with a futuristic analysis which are the countries, parties which will be participating in my blockchain. So what I will take Indian export-import data and see out of 193 countries except Sudan or those countries, how many countries operate with this. So I will see, first ask IBM, if I use your system, is your system sovereign compliant for all the individual companies which my Exim BC blockchain system will get into? They will say yes, right? So I will do an interoperability software between these two. So I have a portion in my blockchain which is kept for KYC. This portion will be interoperating with this. So what I will do, I am a participant in IBM blockchain KYC. I am a single participant. So I will issue information about this guy to this system. This system will issue me back. Yes, he is KYC compliant. when that system gives me KYC compliant, all the documents and his attributes of KYC compliant, his public key, his income tax clearance, and these, whatever it is, it will come and sit in my system. So, although he is dealing with thousands of companies, and one of me is having that thousand, the data which is required for my people is there sitting in my own KYC system, which is nothing but a database. Earlier, I needed a KYC layer for checking the data and storing the data. Today, I don't need anything. I just simply say, hey, this is my client wants to come into my system, send his KYC, send it sits in my system. That's all. So, even though IBM is operating the system, between him and me, there is a contract. That if I lose, or if my client loses, because of reasons applicable to the failure of your KYC system, then all the losses have to be borne by you. Job is done. Any other question? I think it is 1 o'clock now. It's time to close. I have stolen away about 15 minutes of your time because of me coming away a little later. So, otherwise it will have been 2-3 hours. Thank you very much indeed for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.